Hey.
Hey, how you doing?
I'm good.
Are you just about ready?
Yeah, I'm just about ready.
Everything all right?
I'm okay. Just kind of going over this work for today. You know, I'm looking at how, I don't think we realize what Jesus really requires of us and what the questions he's going to pose to us on Judgment Day. I was just reading in the scriptures how he said talking about the judgment of the Gentiles, he said, "For I was hungered and ye gave me meat. I was thirsty and ye gave me drink. I was a stranger and ye took me in. Naked and ye clothed me. I was sick and ye visited me." And then get this, Jesus said, "I was in prison."
Wow.
"And ye came unto me." I was just thinking how, you know, prison ministry, I don't think people realize how important and essential it really is. And it just concerns me that pastors, ministers, leaders as a whole don't understand that even though this particular ministry may not get ties from it, may not get new membership from it, but it's still really essential.
Well, it's a good thing I hear a prophetic worship center. We don't have to worry about that.
Yeah.
But it's a safe place of ministry and worship, so.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. And the brothers at San Quentin, they really do appreciate us and all the work that we're doing and the lessons we're sending them. And so they're staying prayerful and encouraged.
By the way, how is Brother Roy?
Oh, gosh. He's doing great. He's doing great.
Yeah,
he's
good to hear.
Yeah, he's staying prayerful. And we're just looking forward to great things. And like we say here at Prophetic Worship Center, we're excited about our future. So keep us in your prayers. And let me get this together and we'll be on in.
All right. Absolutely. I'll see you soon.
All right. Bless you. I just want to say that it's so important for us as leaders, as pastors, as ministers to realize that there are many men and women who are incarcerated and unfortunately they've been forgotten. But here at Prophetic Worship Center, we understand our purpose and our call is to minister to even those that we may not feel like we're reaping a harvest from. Like I've stated, we may not receive tithes and offerings from those who are incarcerated. We may not see increased membership from them, as some of them are truly serving life sentences. But we thank God that we understand not only are their lives, they're not just numbers to us like they may be in the institutions. These are souls, and Jesus hasn't forgotten about their souls. So we ask you to keep us in your prayers as we strive to do the work of the Lord, to minister to those who maybe some have forgotten, but certainly we haven't forgotten about them. We are praying for our brothers in San Quentin, and just know we're excited about your future here at Prophetic Worship Center. God bless you.
Amen. Ephesians, the 4th chapter, and verse number 1. Do you have it?
Amen.
Amen. And it reads, "I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called." Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray you would bless this word. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may go ahead and take your seats. And for the next few minutes, I want to speak to you from the subject, lock up extended stay. Lock up extended stay. Amen. You know the infamous lock up series. Amen. How it takes camera crews inside the various prisons across the country to give people on the outside a glimpse of the day-to-day occurrences of prison life. It gives perspectives from the inmates on how they live, dealing with the conditions of the prison, the food, the accommodations, whether they have adapted to them or not, good or bad. Also gives perspective from the staff and how they maintain their own safety and how they cope with even the pressures of trying to maintain prison. Amen. It also gives a perspective from the warden on the administrative side and the responsibilities of actually running the prison. And so the lockup extended stay episodes, they usually deal with longer periods covering that particular prison. It may show the situation of an inmate at one time, amen, and then months later show how that same inmate is doing, whether they have improved or maybe they've gotten into some more trouble even while they they are in prison, perhaps getting some time added to their time. Amen. Those are the type of things you see usually in lockup, the extended stay. Amen. And so you can watch this show and see how some have adjusted to prison life because their sentence maybe is 25 years to life. Knowing that they were guilty of the crime, amen, they got caught, tried in the court of law, convicted, and sentenced, they settled in the reality that prison is now, amen, and this has to be real because I'm sure we've all probably at some point in our lives felt that very way, amen, and we have to admit, really deep down on the inside, there's some people that we may know or even have heard of. Amen. That we don't ever want to know that they're walking free down the streets again. Amen, somebody. But then we look at our great apostle Paul. Here he is, a man who has a record. Not only did he do one stay in prison, but he did two. First in Judea and then in Rome. Amen. And in his defense, we'll run and say, but he was a man of God. Come on, somebody. Yeah. Amen. He was in prison for the sake of the gospel. And that is true. Amen. That is true. But we have to remember that Paul did have a past. And since we know that there are consequences to our actions, and even the Bible says that the wages of sin is death, amen, whether literal or figuratively, we can't escape the reality that, amen, he was once against the very Christ he's now preaching about. Amen. He was once, amen, he had once killed people, amen, had people killed and imprisoned for this gospel he now upholds. Amen. And so while he may be a man of God, he finds himself in prison.
Amen.
Amen. I thought it was funny when I read Ephesians 4:1. Amen. Here it is. He's saying, I, therefore, the prisoner. And he's not ashamed of his past. And he's not ashamed of his current situation. Come on, somebody. I, the prisoner, but of the Lord. He's saying, I beseech you that you are worthy of the vocation wherein you were called. Paul, you in prison and you telling me what I should do?
Come on,
somebody. Amen. How often are we willing to take orders from a prisoner? Well, God help us today to be real. Amen. And so he was in prison, a man of God. Amen. But the wisdom we learn about Paul, amen, and about his stay in prison is, as they would say, in prison, he didn't let the time do him. He did the time. Amen. In other words, Paul was productive while he was on lockdown. Amen. He had to obey their rules, and he did realize that his natural freedom had been taken from him, but his spiritual freedom was not taken. Amen. So much so that not only he acknowledged that he was in prison, amen, but he let them know, look, I'm not just in man's prison. Amen. I am a prisoner of the Lord Jesus Christ. Somebody say lockdown. Extended service. Amen. It would be lost. Letting him know that I have called you and I have purpose for your life and you cannot die. Amen. Until that purpose has been fulfilled. And so Paul leaves us. Amen. With these wonderful, beautiful writings from prison. Amen. He leaves us these writings. Amen. And so the next time you read Ephesians and Colossians and Philippians and Philemon, remember he was in prison when he wrote these letters. And so from prison he leaves us with these writings about marriage and relationships. Although he himself was not married.
Amen.
And so he leaves us instructions about spiritual warfare. Amen. Right from prison. God have mercy. Can anything good come from prison? Amen. And so from prison, he's teaching us all of these lessons on humility. He had to explain how a Christian should live and should walk and should love and appreciate life even under the most unpleasant circumstances. He had to remind remind us that this world is not where our hope lies, but we have a hope of glory in the coming of the Lord. All of this revelation, all of this insight, all of this good word and this good teaching, it came from prison. God help us today. Amen, somebody. Amen. So these same letters we shout about, and these same letters that we preach about, are the same ones that were written by a murderer. The same letters, amen, written by a slanderer and a torturer who was converted. Amen. I say he was converted. Amen. A murderer, a slanderer, a torturer. But he had been converted. But he was in prison. And even when God told Ananias to go witness to him on the road of Damascus, you remember what Ananias said? He basically said, do you know who he is? The one you're telling me to go witness to, do you know who he is? Amen. But God knew who he was. Amen. And God knew how valuable Paul would be to the kingdom. Amen. And that's a true testament of God. Amen. Seeing the best in someone. Amen. When they're at their very worst. Amen. His experience with God was so life transforming that he had no choice but to serve him with his whole being, whether in prison or free. He declared, I'm a prisoner of the Lord. Amen. I'm a prisoner of Christ. So that even when I'm free from a jail cell, I'm still on spiritual parole. Somebody say, lock up. Extended stay. It doesn't matter if people believe that I've truly been converted. It doesn't matter if people believe that my experience with Christ on the road to Damascus was real. People don't always believe you've truly been born again. People don't always believe that you've truly been saved. People don't always believe that you've truly been delivered. And they sure question your deliverance if you're trying to tell a testimony from a prison cell. Amen, somebody. But we have so great cloud of witnesses of what God is able to do. He wants to do it, and from the locale he chooses to do it from. And so it doesn't matter what people believe, whether they believe he was changed or not. We have the word of God today, and yet written by a prisoner, to let us know that God is able to do it. God will do it, and God can do it. It doesn't matter. People, can you imagine? People probably thought that he was just having some type of jailhouse religion. That's what they want us to believe today. Anytime somebody goes to prison, people want us to believe that they're just no good, throw the book at them and forget about them. But saints of God, we are required of God to go into the prisons and snatch those souls out of the pit of hell. Oh God, help us today. We have a misconception. We only want to minister to those that are bringing us benefit. We only want to minister to those that are bringing us ties in the church. We only want to minister to those that can increase our membership. But on the day of judgment, God is going to question us. And he's going to remind us, when I was in prison, you didn't come see about me, did you? When Jesus went, when you were in prison, when my son went to prison, when my daughter went to prison. Amen. If you serve them, if you bless them, then you're blessing me. Come on, somebody. Somebody say, lock up. Extended stay. Amen. So it doesn't matter. Amen. Whether somebody is doing 25 years of life. Amen. Or if they're just doing a short-term sentence. Amen. But one day they spend in prison. Like I described it as hell on earth. Amen, somebody. It takes people covering them and protecting them and interceding on their behalf that the angels will keep their arms of protection around them. And if you hear somebody who wants to make a difference and who wants to make a change in their life and they're crying out for prayer and they're crying out for help, who are we to have stipulations about who we're going to minister mercy. And I show my grace where I choose to show my grace. Amen, somebody. It's not to us to judge. Come on, somebody. Amen. If you want to be judged, then you be the first one to judge somebody else. Amen, somebody. Just because you didn't get caught in your mess doesn't mean you didn't do the crime. God just had mercy on you. Amen. And didn't allow that to be your process to get you back in line. But for some people, amen, it required them to go through a hellish situation. Just like Jonah. Jonah didn't do what God told him to do. Amen. Up front, like he had the opportunity to do. All he had to do was obey what God said do. And decide to go his own way.
And go with them wherever they go. And that's what we need. For my spirit
CEO, we need you to lead us and guide us. We need you to order our steps. We need you to protect us. We need you to stop us when we go to do wrong. Come on, somebody. I don't want to be released from your spiritual prison. Keep me on lockdown so I can be saved. Keep me on lockdown so I can be the great witness. Keep me
to wake up.
Yes.
As he would say to me, this is an unfortunate
unfortunate situation. Sometimes we have to go through things just to get us lined up with God's will. Like I said before, you may not have gotten caught, but that doesn't mean you didn't do the crime. God just chose to cover you in your sin and your error. But he still expects us, amen, to line up with his will.
I just hope the message got across today that prison ministry is really ordained by God, and it doesn't matter who it is incarcerated. God expects us to reach out to those souls.
One thing about our brother Roy, well, he was a member before he went in. You know, he's still a member now, and Prophetic Worship Center, we love him, and we just wait for him to come home and embrace him with loving arms and just welcome him back on the church grind.
Thank you, and I guess that's what I love about Prophetic Worship Center too. Now, not just being the pastor, but knowing that it's a safe place of worship for me and my family as well. I love you. Thank you so much.